Hello friends, welcome once again to the lectures being organized by Aligarh Society of History and Archaeology, ASHA, and Ganga Jamuni Heritage. Today we have with us Dr. Mahalakshmi Ramakrishnan, a well-known academic who is a professor at JNU. Her field of specialization is early medieval period. Her interests span over areas like the development of Brahmanical and Buddhist art and architecture in South Asia and tribal histories of South Asia, particularly the Brahmanical Buddhist tribal interactions in the pre-modern period, apart from studying Tamil influences in early historic and early medieval Sri Lanka. Another of our preferred field of interest is interrogating gender and patriarchy in early India. She has authored two well-received books, The Making of the Goddess Koravai Durga in the Tamil Traditions, which was published by Penguin India in 2011, and the second book, The Book of Lakshmi, again by Penguin, but Penguin Viking, 2009. She has been the recipient of many grants and honors. In fact, she is not only a professor of history at the well-known Jawaharlal Nehru University, but is also, since the last 2 years, the incumbent secretary of the largest body of professional historians in India, the Indian History Congress. Under her stewardship, the Indian History Congress organized two successful sessions, and after the COVID, her visionary approach and will to walk with times saw Indian History Congress holding a crucial 2-day webinar and a very well-received S.C. Mishra Memorial Lecture delivered online by Professor Mridula Mukherjee. With her in the helm of affairs in the Indian History Congress, the Indian History Congress has now gained a presence both on Facebook and YouTube. Hope this tradition is carried forward and further developed. Today, Professor Dr. Mahalakshmi Ramakrishnan will speak on the topic which is close to her heart, locating gender in medieval South Indian history. Over to you, Maha.
Thank you so very much. It's a great honor to be invited to speak by ASHA and by Ganga Jamuni Heritage. And I would like to thank the organizers for asking me to come in. I have listened to some of the lectures, and some of the best historians in the field have been talking about their work, their interests, and presenting them through such a platform. And that is, I think, a very, very important thing for all of us to engage in, particularly at this moment of time when there are so many distortions of history that are taking place. I think that we really need to engage with this kind of putting forward our research and our work to a larger audience. And the webinar format, the online format, accidentally perhaps, but nevertheless, I think this is here to stay now. It has provided us with a very good opportunity to actually reach out through the new media. So thank you very much, Professor Rezavi and Ms. Siddhi, for inviting me. It's with some degree of apprehension, because I know that other scholars have presented very, very scholarly lectures over here. What I thought I would do here is actually raise some of the issues, some of the concerns that one has when we talk about gender in the early Indian context itself, and of course, particularly in the case of South India, because that's where a lot of my work has focused. I have worked with sources that are composed in Sanskrit and in Tamil. The inscriptions that we have from here, the texts that we have from here, and so on, are very specific in the kind of information that they give to us. So when you have a certain kind of source base, you're also enabled and limited at the same time. And that is really one of the biggest challenges for us as historians. So I thought that I would place some of those challenges that we have faced as historians. What is it that we have been able to address full on while tackling those challenges, and where still we have certain gaps, primarily not because we have not asked those questions, primarily because of the sources themselves and the ways in which they foreclose certain kinds of questions from being asked. So it's in that sense that that one really needs to keep thinking about the possibilities that integration of sources allows us, but we also need to think about the issue of, just because something is not there, does it mean it didn't exist? Or how do we read through absences and silences? A very well-known scholar, Rajeshwari Sundararajan, talked about this in a very wonderful work called Real and Imagined Women, in which he talks about how we have so many instances where women are just written out of the record. They are not there. They don't exist. Now, do we look at those absences itself critically? How do we bring up those absences and bring meaning through those absences also? It becomes far more difficult actually to do something like this when we're looking at early Indian history. And the issues, of course, are those of the kinds of genres in which the sources are presented before us or exist before us. And so it's in that sense that we really need to grapple with these kinds of theoretical issues that have been raised by feminist scholars. But we also need to think about the limitations for us when we are looking so far back in time. So while I think that the theoretical issue is very important, the methodological issues are certainly primary. As historians, we have to give primacy to that. And with that, I would request that the slides be shown. Have they begun? Yeah. Thank you. So the issue of locating gender in the history of South Indian history, really in the early medieval history of South India, really stems from these kinds of concerns that many scholars have raised. But before we actually begin, I would like to pay my homage to Professor D.N. Jha, who passed away 2 days ago, a very eminent scholar of ancient Indian history. And while he himself did not really frontally discuss issues related to gender, he certainly was aware of how we need to bring in questions related to gender and caste in addition to class when we do look at our sources to provide any meaningful social and economic history. Professor Jha has mentored so many students. He has been such a great force for the fraternity of historians. He has been at the helm of the Indian History Congress, of which I now have the privilege of also being a part. And in so many ways, he has been a trailblazer, like various other scholars like Professor R.S. Sharma, Professor Irfan Habib, Professor Bipin Chandra, and so on. We will sorely miss Professor D.N. Jha, not merely because of his scholarship, which was very, very rich, which was of the kind that would stay on no matter what new researches come in. That we also would miss him because of the kinds of stands that he took, because of the ways in which he came forward to refute the communalization of history. And since it is the agenda of both Asha and Ganga Jamni Heritage to highlight the shared past that we have had, to talk against the communalization of history, to talk against the stereotyping and prejudices that seem to have become very commonplace in the kind of histories that are being peddled out by news channels and by news magazines. It is in that context particularly that someone like Professor D.N. Jha showed us the way. And we all, I'm sure, humbly pay our him. We will miss him sorely, but the best way in which we can pay tribute to him is by not allowing these issues to go unchallenged. That we would need to, like him, also question the kinds of prejudices that exist. We would need to present a very rigorous and scientific history, a history that is based on a study of sources, a history that looks at issues of plurality, looks at issues of dissent, but above all, to look at a history that binds rather than one that seeks to emphasize fissures. So it is in that spirit that I would like to now move on to my talk on gender. Some preliminaries before one goes any further. Gender itself as a field of study is one that has been talked of by a number of scholars, both in the Western context as well as in the Indian context. Aparna Basu, this very well-known historian of gender and of women's education in particular, writes in this very interesting essay of hers on women's history about how it's not a coincidence that the earliest women's histories that were written in the Indian context was at a time when women were increasingly participating in public life. It is in that context when the presence of women in social movements, in political movements was very prominent, was becoming more and more visible and conspicuous, that we also had scholars who began to look at women, their roles in society, their functions, and so on. And there was a tendency, of course, to glorify certain periods. There was a tendency to look at very, shall we say, superficial issues at times, you know, the ornamentation, the dress, and so on. But there were also some very, very significant works, such as that which was done on Buddhism. I.B. Horner and Mrs. Rhys-Davids were amongst those who worked on Buddhism, who talked about the theories and the theras and the wonderful gathas, the songs that were written by the theris, the Buddhist nuns, the elder nuns, who actually brought in their personal experience of salvation in those songs. So in that sense, you had some really pathbreaking works, even at this very early period, even at a time when there was not much of a critical idea of what do we mean when we talk about bringing women into history. Is it that we just identify them, or are we actually going beyond identification? The issue of women as a social category really begins to be talked about in the 50s and the 60s. Scholars like Professor R.S. Sharma first talk about this. Others also go, follow, and in his stead, they look at the way in which caste and class are closely tied with issues of gender, the way in which women, for instance, were very often tagged with the lower castes in the Brahmanical texts and in other kinds of textual sources that we have for ancient India. So this importance of seeing women as a social category rather than pinpointing individuals, talking about their attainments and achievements, no doubt a very important area, but to look beyond that. The issue of structures. social structures, looking at institutions. To talk of marriage, for instance, as an institution, to talk about inequalities that exist in society in terms of women's access to resources, women's access to public places, and so on, that also began to be brought up by scholars. And amongst the luminaries in this field, you have Uma Chakravarti and Kumkum Roy, but a whole host of others thereafter who also began to take up these issues and began to, in a very evocative manner, bring women back into the lens of history through which we could actually identify and talk about their experiences, their location in history. But not all sources really can tell us about the experiences of women. Largely, the kinds of sources that we have seem to provide a certain normative understanding of women's lives and women's roles. And even that began to be questioned very intricately in various kinds of writings. The idea of gender as a social category, as a category of historical analysis, was first flagged by Joan Wallach Scott in this wonderful essay in which she says that what do we actually mean when we are talking about gender? Are we just using the term gender as a substitute for women? Are we just actually talking only about women when we say gender? And so what is it that we add? What is that value that comes in when we are actually bringing gender into the historical inquiry? And there she raises the issue of how we are actually looking at social relations among sexes. And we are looking at the issue of the cultural construction of gender, of women and of men. Women and men, therefore, not just being born as women and men, but that they are made into women and men. An idea that was actually raised much earlier by Simone de Beauvoir in her work, The Second Sex. So you have really building on that kind of a discussion and understanding. Joan Scott says that for historians, what we do need to recognize is that when we bring women into the canvas of history, when we talk about women as subjects in history, we are actually bringing a larger social structure also in, because women, like men, are embedded in a certain social structure. We find that in many societies across the world, in different time periods, issues related to inequality amongst the sexes exist. We find that patriarchy and patrilineal traditions predominate. And it is in that context that we need to talk about this social structure and how, therefore, women and men are made into women and men. There are ideas of masculinity, there are ideas of femininity, there are ideas of the roles and functions that men and women are to perform. There are ideas of also how they are supposed to behave. So in so many different ways, you have society that constructs certain kinds of norms, certain kinds of rules, prescribes ways of being. And that is what we get at when we are talking about gender, even when we are focusing on women. And she and others have defended the focus on women by arguing that given that women tend to be left out of the historical record, by bringing women in itself, we are actually bringing in that larger picture. We are bringing in the issue of the social structure. And I would go along with these eminent scholars who make this kind of an argument. And that is why, while my talk says locating gender in the history of medieval South India, I am going to be primarily focusing on women, but women as they are embedded within social structures. The next slide, please. There are three ways in which I would like to present my ideas related to gender in medieval Tamil Nadu. And so here I'm, while I've used the broad area of South India, I decided to focus more closely on Tamil Nadu, primarily because of the time constraint. And also because this is an area on which I have done a lot of primary work, and I would prefer to present my own research before you. So the three broad ways in which one can try to locate gender in the history of medieval Tamil Nadu. And one of these ways is by looking at women in terms of their economic productivity, in terms of their activities which contribute to the economy, in terms of their access to resources. The idea of women's work is something that has been raised by various scholars across various time periods, but it is still something that requires much more engagement and analysis. And there have been some very important works in the context of South India. The work of my colleague and senior scholar Vijaya Ramaswamy, who unfortunately also died after the coronavirus broke out in May of 2020. Well, her work is her legacy. She has done a lot of work on the issue of women's contribution to the economy, women's work as such, how we can actually, reading through very fragmentary kind of references, identify the kind of women that, the kind of work that women were engaged in. The second major issue that we could look at while talking about gender in the medieval Tamil context is to look at the way in which they prefigure in the social institutions of family, and to look in terms of the kinds of kinship ties that our sources reveal to us. So where do we actually see, how do we actually see these women when we locate them within the family, when we locate them within the kinship ties that are being forged, which are so very important for the maintenance of a social structure. Now, various scholars, Professor Suvira Jaiswal, for instance, in her wonderful presidential address to the Indian History Congress, has raised the issue of how important it is for us when we talk about gender to bring in the issue of family and kinship. She looks at the Vedic texts and she talks about how there are ideas related to the married couple. There are ideas related to the family that the woman comes into after her marriage, her natal family, the way in which marriage alliances are forged, and the kind of position that is accorded to women within the set of relationships that we would call the private relationships, right? And in all of this, she shows in a very nuanced way spaces that may have existed, which are more of individual spaces. Largely, the social spaces that we are looking at are those where we can see the subordination of women, whether we are talking in terms of the dampati, whether we are talking in terms of the kula. So very, very important intervention there as far as bringing gender into the study of early Indian history. Jaya Tyagi has looked at another kind of textual tradition, the Grihya Sutras, prescriptive texts which relate to the domestic lives of people. And these texts are normative texts. They are primarily ritualistic. But there again, Jaya Tyagi has shown in such a nuanced way, the way in which the household and the family are structured through the lens of gender. The third way in which we can bring in the issue of gender is by looking at women in religion, looking at their participation in religious life, looking at the spaces that they have in religious life, and through that to try and look at the way in which society actually allows women to follow a religious path, whether in a domestic context or in a public context. So I'd request you to move to the next one, slide. Yes, the context for the early medieval period between 600 and 1300 CE is one where we have the formation of the early state, as has been discussed by various scholars like Noboru Karashima, Nilakanta Shastri himself, the Doyen of South Indian history, talking about this, about the importance of the state, looking at particularly the Chola state in his massive two-volume study of the Cholas, but not really looking beyond the dynastic tradition, not looking essentially at the political structure. And that is something that was taken up by scholars like Subbarayalu, like Noboru Karashima and Champakalakshmi. And at a later point, scholars like Stein, Keshavan Veluthat, and others have also brought their understanding, their analysis of various kinds of sources and so on to enrich this field, essentially looking at the way in which, with the growth of a state structure, what was essentially a tribal kind of society gets transformed. You have a huge administrative apparatus that comes up. You have a bureaucracy that can be identified. And primarily, the basis of the state that all of these scholars talk about is agriculture. There is a lot that is invested into the extension and expansion and intensification of agriculture. And it is in that context, the changes that come about because of that expansion is what we see as extremely significant in terms of bringing about changes in society, bringing about changes in the culture of that region. This is a region where you have, as I've already mentioned, tribal norms, tribal traditions and beliefs, and social structures also are very much tribal in their origin and in their development until this point of time. But what you have is, with the early medieval period, with the coming up of the state structure, very, very important new element that comes into the region, which is the Brahmanical presence, the presence of Brahmanas as individuals and as groups who are being granted lands by the kings, who provide some kind of legitimacy to the rulers, who create genealogies for the kings. And in this manner, they are given also primacy. So there is this alliance that develops between the kings and the Brahmins during this period of time, both of them working towards the sustenance of the power structure, the establishment of the power structure, and the maintenance of it at this point of time. We have a large number of inscriptional records in this region. This little chart that I've made for you is based on those that have been done by Subbarayalu and by Noboru Karashima. What you can see clearly from these, from this, is that the bulk of inscriptions that we have of the early medieval period, a number about 19,000. We have a total of about 28,000 that come from this region between the 10th and the 17th century, or is it slightly beyond that? That the bulk of this actually comes from this early medieval period. So inscriptions being official records telling you about the kinds of changes that are taking place over there. The kings are instituting these records primarily to assert their authority in new areas which they are now conquering and they're bringing under their control. So it's in that context that these are very, very important official documents. Some scholars like Sanjay Subramaniam, Vel Cheru Narayan Rao and others would say that these are biased documents. They are official documents, so they don't really have any relevance, which I think is a very spurious argument. all documents may have some biases. That doesn't mean that they are useless for the historian. The historian has to know how to wade through the source itself and the limitations that are posed by the source. But more importantly, the source it provides us with an ample amount of information which we do need to take into consideration. So going in the tradition of scholars whom I've mentioned, I have also looked at a vast range of inscriptions from the region, and clearly, what we can see for this region is that not merely are we talking about a political and economic transformation, we are also looking at a social and cultural transformation that occurs because of the nature of political changes that are taking place at this point of time. My own work has been largely on issues related to the cultural transformations, looking at religion, looking at art, looking at the textual traditions in particular, to see how there are certain kinds of elements, and inscriptions also are texts in that sense, because you have panegyrics, you have a lot of very flowery language and literary sensibility that is being used in the inscriptions, which are telling you about the intermingling of the northern Sanskritic tradition with the southern Tamil ones. So there are those who even today would insist that there is something called a pure Tamil tradition. I would beg to differ. That certainly what we see in the early medieval period is a very substantial and a substantive intermingling of cultures, where we see the northern traditions, which are marked primarily by the Sanskritic Brahmanical element, but also very importantly by the Buddhist and the Jain elements, their influences, their ideas, the language itself, Pali, which continues to be used in the in this region during this time period. In fact, one of the arguments that is given by scholars who have studied Buddhism during this time period has been that Buddhism possibly died out in this region because they continued to use Pali and did not shift to Tamil, unlike the Jains. So that intermingling that I'm talking about is something that is very, very strong at this point of time. The next slide, please. What do we have in terms of economic and social changes that are taking place at this point of time? We have land grants that are being given to individuals, to groups, to religious institutions, and there are different kinds of religious institutions that are mentioned. Largely, the land grants that are being given to individuals and also to groups is in the context of the Brahmanical temple. The temple becomes a very important institution at this point of time. It is a religious institution, but it has social and economic dimensions, as shown by scholars like George Spencer and Champakalakshmi. What do we mean when we say this? Temples began to acquire land. They were gifted these lands. They needed certain kinds of provisions to maintain the rituals and also maintain those who were performing services within the temples. And it is in that context that the temple becomes almost like a landowner, as Professor D.N. Jha argued in his paper on temples as feudal lords. While the idea of the feudal lord is something that has been contested, the point is, as Professor Jha pointed out amongst others, the temples did become these very large institutions having a great deal of socioeconomic power. And what we have is, on the basis of about 1,000 inscriptions, so, you know, of those 19,000 inscriptions, at least, about 12,000 belong to the Cholas. of those, a minuscule number of about 1,000 were studied in great detail by scholars like Karashima and Subbarayalu. And what did they find? They found that we can actually engage in a very serious social history. We were to just look, and economic history, if we were to just look at the inscriptions carefully, look at the information that we get from the inscriptions. We are told about different kinds of land. We are talking about the Mayakkal or the transformation of land. We are talking of the Nirnilam or the wetlands that existed. We are talking of the gardens that are being gifted to the temples, the Nandavanams, and we are talking about the Nattams, the residential areas. We have information about agriculture itself, about irrigation, the kulams, the ponds, and the vaika, the channels. So much of information that we have in these absolutely splendid sources that the rulers of the early medieval period left behind for us. What we also have is references to communities. We have the Brahmins who are mentioned. We have various other groups like the potters, the washermen, the garland makers, those at the lower level. We have administrators at the higher level who are also mentioned. So really a huge range of things that we find in these land grants. And clearly, the state depended on the agricultural economy. And so the land grants and also the inscriptions themselves at large are really telling you about the importance of agriculture at this point of time. But as has been shown by Champak Lakshmi and Ranabir Chakravarti and others, there is also a shift towards trade. There is an emphasis on trade, at least from the 11th century onwards in this region, which becomes much more vibrant and visible and conspicuous subsequently in the medieval period, later in the medieval period. May I have the next slide, please? Just to give you an idea of the kind of information that is there in an inscription, this is a translation that is taken directly from the South Indian Inscriptions, Volume 2, Number 4. These are inscriptions that were collected from the great temple at Tanjavur, built by Rajaraja Chola, the great imperial Chola king, who ruled from 985 to 1014 AD. In this inscription, you can see from the text of this inscription, a small excerpt of which I've given you, that we are getting information about a money economy. We are getting information of a very advanced kind of measurement tradition that was firmly established by this time. You have different measurements that are mentioned in different inscriptions. What we also hear about is the social organization of the villages where you have the Urnattam, the residential area, but we are also told about a Parayacheri, we are told about the Kammanacheri, in some inscriptions we are told about the Eeracheri. Now the Parayas, the Kammanas, the Eeravas and so on, these were the servile classes as far as the society at that point of time is concerned. So what do we get from this information? We are able to understand that clearly, in the early medieval period, you have a social organization where the Ur itself was actually referring to the peasants, the Velala caste, that other castes were actually segregated. You had special areas in which they, quarters in which they lived, and so on. So there are, in fact, in some of these inscriptions from Tanjavur itself, instances of even the cremation grounds for the Parayas, for the Eeravas, and so on, being talked of as separate, as different from the cremation grounds for the Velalas. So when we do talk about how caste provides us with so much of cohesion and harmonious society that develops, the Jajmani system, the village life that is glorified in some quarters, both popular and fortunately very rarely in academic circles, we are really talking about ignoring of this this very copious evidence that we have that we had a stringently hierarchized society, a society where people were segregated in terms of their living areas, their residential areas, but also in death that they were segregated. So a new element that comes in, something that I was talking about earlier also, a new element that we are looking at in the early medieval period in South India, when we are talking of the intermingling of traditions and cultures. As part of that intermingling of traditions and cultures, we are also looking at caste coming in and taking firm root in this region. And while the Varna Jati system is not replicated in the same way as we find it in northern India, we have a different kind of organization of the caste structure. But nevertheless, what we have is the idea of giving importance and status to the Brahmanas and to certain other groups, and of looking at certain groups as polluting, is something that we clearly find in these kinds of sources. The next slide, please. Now, when we come to women and trying to bring in the issue of gender, what do we find when we look at the inscriptions? Largely, when we talk about work such as that of the peasant or the agriculturist or the weaver or the potter and so on, there is a tendency to only talk about the men who are engaged in this work. It has been shown by various scholars through field studies that this is not actually quite true. In fact, women perform some of the most crucial tasks in agriculture, but very rarely find them mentioned in earlier records in pre-modern periods in these ways, in a very explicit way, talking about the kind of work. Certainly, in the early medieval period in the Tamil region, we do not really have such references. We can glean such references when they come out by some tangential kind of mention in the record, where you are talking about a man and his wife and so on. In that sense, you can try and see that, yes, there were women also who were engaged in this kind of work. But otherwise, you really don't find women's work as such that is very visible to us. So the better way for a lot of us who have been looking at women in economic terms, in terms of their economic contribution and presence in the early medieval period, we have no doubt that they contributed to the economy. But where they are visible in our sources is where we find them in terms of the control of certain kinds of resources. These resources could be something which is small, which is ordinary, like a lamp that they are gifting in the religious establishments. It could be in terms of some kind of an offering of a prasad for the rituals in one of the temples or in a Jain context and so on. Or it could also be in the context of them making land grants, meaning that they did have some kind of control over resources. Who were these women who had control over resources? It is largely those who belonged to the elite classes. Primarily, even there, it is those who are married to kings, who are the daughters of kings, and who are the mothers of rulers. It is in that context that we largely find references to this kind of large-scale control of resources. So the land grants largely are made by such women. We also have references to other kinds of women who make these small gifts. But a very, very important category of women that we find in the inscriptions from the early medieval period is that which is referred to as the temple women. Now, who are these temple women? The temple women were those who lived within the precincts of the temple or in proximity to the temple. They were attached to temples and they were given certain kinds of tasks to perform within the temples. What were these tasks? Primarily, they related to certain kinds of requirements related to the ritual needs within the temple. So these women received some remuneration and they therefore obviously had some resources. And it is in that sense that we look at these women as actually controlling their resources and also having agency as far as those resources are concerned. So it's one thing to talk about having resources, but it's another issue when we are actually looking at how that resource is in the hands of the women. Is it actually in the hands of these women, or does it actually get controlled by someone else? And here Leslie Orr points out to us that in the case of the Brahmanis, who are mentioned in the early medieval Tamil inscriptions, primarily of the Chola period, from the middle of the 9th century to about the middle of the 13th century, what you find is references to a man, a Muduhan, who is acting on behalf of these women. He could be her son, he could be her brother, but the fact is that you have a male who is actually interceding on behalf of these women. And primarily, where do we find these references? In the context of some kind of land transaction. So it's a very significant element that we have, that while you have royalty who have some control over their resources by themselves, the women of the royal class, you have temple women who have resources and agency, you have the Brahmana women, it appears, who do not have that kind of agency. What we also find in the temple inscriptions, a number of references to queens as builders. They are building monuments, they are building primarily religious monuments, they are temples. They could also be Jain temples, not just the Brahmanical ones, but temples that are being built primarily to the two major Puranic deities, Shiva and Vishnu. And you have, for instance, in the Pallava period, reference to so many queens, such as Charu Devi, such as Reva, Dhamma Mahadevi, and the Ripatunga Varma's mother, Rangapataka, who's the wife of Rajasimha. And so on. So a large number of such references which indicate to us that these were women who very clearly had some control over resources, and they were able to show this in the manner in which they were gifting to the religious institutions. We also have a very, very interesting kind of reference in the inscriptions where women themselves were given as a donation. And this is primarily in the context of the temple women. The next slide, please. Before I talk about the temple women as donations, I would like to focus a little on this particular figure, this Chola queen called Chembiyan Mahadevi, a very, very important figure. She is known as the daughter of a chieftain, Maraperumal. She's known as the wife of Gandharaditya Chola, the very well-known, prominent Chola ruler who is thought to have been a bhakti saint. You have her son, who was Uttama Chola, the uncle of Rajaraja Chola. And very interestingly, when referring to her as the mother of Uttama Chola, she is referred to as the one who held in her womb this great king. Uttamachore Devarai Thiruvairu Vaika Udaya Piratiyar, Sri Sembiyan Mahadeviyar. So the very interesting ways in which this queen is referred to as a daughter, as a wife, as a mother in the inscriptions, but very important in terms of her contribution to public life is a large number of inscriptions which are issued in her name, and both in the time of her son as well as in her in the time of Rajaraja Chola. You have 63 such inscriptions, 31 villages that are talked about in these inscriptions. Of these, in 30 villages at least, we have her gifting and building activities and the provisions that she was making for the maintenance of the temples that she was building. This is something that we find in her inscriptions. In fact, her temples or the monuments built by her were seen as so distinctive that there was actually a Sembiyan type that was believed to have come about. The Sembiyan type having slight changes in architecture as well as in the artistic traditions that they had. This is something that's very, very important for those of us who look at art and architecture, that the monument is a space that has a particular purpose, but also it has a certain visuality. And where that visuality is being contributed to in a very significant manner is by Sembiyan Mahadevi actually adding a very important niche image, which is there in the typical niche images that we have in the Brahmanical temple from the Tamil region, where you have an image of Brahma, you would have one of Durga, and you would have other such deities, you would have Dakshinamurti and so on. She introduces the figure of Nataraja Shiva into the Shaiva temples at this point of time. So that's possibly the first instance where we have Nataraja Shiva, who's given a place on the wall of the Vimana in the temples, and that place stays in later temples also. That becomes the space. The southern wall of the Garbhagriha on the outside would have a figure of Nataraj. So she, a woman who made immense contribution, who is talked about in many inscriptions. It is not just herself, but it is also others who refer to her. So you have about 10 records that have been discussed by scholars, where you have other queens and princesses, as well as her retinue, that is her palace women, her attendants, who were making certain gifts. And the gift was on her birth asterism, which is this particular Chitra month, and Jyeshtha is her star. On this occasion, that there should be some kind of offering and so on, is something that these people made provisions for. What is also very interesting, and in the previous slide, let me go back. This image that we have here is of the 10th century, and it is now in the Freer Gallery in the US. And there's been much debate about this particular figure. Many scholars would argue that although the goddess figures, particularly in the Shaiv traditions, and she was a great, as I've already mentioned, great devotee of Shiva, built many temples for Shiva, the goddess Parvati was represented in this form, with her right hand raised as if holding a flower and her left hand hanging by the side. But many scholars would argue, because of the provenance of this particular image, that this is actually Sembiyan Mahadevi, the queen, who is represented as a goddess-like figure. The next slide. This particular image that we have is one of Chembiyan Mahadevi making a grant in honor of her husband who has died. And so you have that image on top, which shows her husband seated before the Shivalinga and praying, and she's seated behind. And then you have the inscription that talks about various provisions that she makes in his memory. The next slide, please. Now, I talked about how women themselves were donations. And these women were known as the Devar Adiyal, the temple women. And you have a number of inscriptions, but this one in particular is one which has been commented upon by numerous scholars from Tanjavur, the Rajarajeshwaram temple. This is published in South Indian Inscriptions, volume 2, number 66. And here you will see that a large number of people have been moved from one temple to another. So these are people who are attached to a temple to perform certain services. And so you have watchmen, you have those who are musicians, and you also have temple women who are brought in. And as you will see when you read this inscription, there is a very elaborate discussion of each of the people who are being brought in to serve in this particular temple. And amongst these, you have 300 temple women who are actually mentioned by name. So I've given only one woman over here, the first woman who is mentioned. But what you can see is there's already a very elaborate system that has been institutionalized, where the temple, as I've already mentioned, has become a very important social and economic institution, which also allows for the extension of political power because of the kind of control that the rulers had over these temples. They made certain kinds of grants and donations, but also through those temples, they were able to access the hinterland. They were able to gain resources. So it's in that sense that the temples are very important. And in these temples, you have women who were being attached as people who would offer certain kind of service, and they were being given certain kind of remuneration. We don't, unfortunately, find other such references where women are singled out as being given remuneration. We may assume, as I already said, that the potter's household is there, the weaver's household is there, and so on, that all of them, and of course the agriculturist, that in all of these households, the women were also participating in the labor, but we really do not get a sense of the remuneration that they get for the work that they perform in the household. It is only in the case of the temple women that we have such elaborate information as far as their economic resources are concerned. The next slide, please. So when we look at the issue of women, family and kinship, it's closely, actually the three themes that I've talked about, they really should not be separated. They are all interlinked in many ways. I've already mentioned how when we look at the elite women who controlled resources in inscriptions, we have them mentioned in very specific ways. They're mentioned as the wife of a king or of a chieftain. They're mentioned as the mother of a ruler and so on. So the terms that are used for them are very, very interesting. They are referred to as Deviyar, Piratiyar, and so on. You also have royal women, that is women who are attached to royalty rather than royal women. Leslie Orr refers to them as royal women, but I would not agree with her on that. These are women who are attendants. They are women who may belong to noble families, who may be from the families of courtiers and so on, but they are attached to queens and to princesses. There are other kinds of women also who could be a part of this, who would be more in terms of providing menial services to the queens. But all of them are referred to as women who belong to a velam or a palace, or that they are part of a parivaram or a retinue. Amongst these women, you might have references to some who are an anukki or those who are a poki. That is, those who are intimate with the king or with some royal personage. So we do have such references. So these are women who are a part of the larger social structure in the sense that they belong to the palace, they perform certain services, they may be the ones who hold the betel leaf box, they may be the ones who are fanning the royal women and so on, or there could be others, as I've already mentioned, who are performing more menial kinds of services. And then you have references to the Brahmani in the text. You also have references to those who are Panicheya Pendugal. These are generally, again, in the context of the temple that we find them. Pani meaning, of course, work, the women who are to do various kinds of work. And amongst these, there's very interesting references to some of them as being varvachi, that is married women. I've written about this elsewhere in a volume edited by Professor Kumkum Roy on the household, where the idea of varva, or you know, the idea of your life itself as one that is mentionable when you are married is something that comes up in a text like the Tirukkural. And then you also have such an idea that continues in other texts of a later period. So clearly what we have in all of these references is when we find that there is a family context in which women are placed, invariably the family relationships are clearly spelled out. They are mentioned as the daughters or wives or mothers. In the case of men, clearly that they are the sons of a certain male, that they belong to a lineage is spelt out, but you do not have references, of course, to their mothers and their wives and so on, unless they are of the ruling class. The next slide. Yeah, something that is very distinctive about the South Indian tradition is the cross-cousin style of marriage. In this marriage, you have a daughter who could marry her mother's brother, or you can have a man who can marry the maternal uncle's daughter. And you have, even in the royal family, for instance, of the Cholas, such alliances that are there with the eastern Chalukyas. For instance, Rajaraja's daughter, Kundavai, is married to the eastern Chalukya ruler, Vimaladitya. And Kundavai's son is Rajaraja Narendra, who is then married to Kundavai's brother's daughter. That is Rajendra Chola's daughter, who is Amanga Devi. And then you have Rajendra Chola, who has a daughter who is Madhurantaki. And Rajendra's daughter, who has married Rajaraja Narendra, has a son who is Rajendra the second Chalukya, who takes on the title of Kulotunga, who becomes then the Chola king. Because we are told there is no heir in a later text, we are told, a text that belongs to the time of Kulotunga, we are told that there was no other heir, and therefore, because he had to step in and save that lineage, he came in and became the Chola king. But that same text also tells you about how right from the beginning it was known that he was going to be a great Chola ruler and so on. But that's a different story. The fact is that cross-cousin marriage is very, very intrinsic to the nature of kinship that we find in the Dravidian traditions. And in different parts of South India, you find that this exists. And in the Tamil region, even the kings follow this tradition. So while in the Sanskritic tradition, so when we talk about intermingling, we have absorption of the caste tradition, but there are variations in that. You have what is called the left hand and the right hand caste that come up, the Valangai and the Idangai. In the case of the marriage traditions, we do not have the same kind of Anuloma and Pratiloma that you have in the Sanskritic traditions. Instead, we have actually clearly there is a blood relationship that is there, but it is something that it is has been prevalent until very recent times. Increasingly, people have moved away away from this for various medical reasons, but this is the characteristic feature of the kinship as far as South India is concerned. The next slide, please. Yeah. As far as women outside the marriage are concerned, you have references to those who are pati ilar, that is those without a pati or a husband. And then you have these women, as I've already mentioned, the Devar Adiyar. They are talked of as singers and dancers. They're making flower garlands. They're just attending on the gods when there are certain sevas that are taking place in the temple. They're sweeping the courtyards, washing the vessels and so on. So you have all kinds of jobs in which you find such temple women employed. You also have, as Leslie Orr has very beautifully put it in her work, donors, devotees and daughters of God, them being referred to as Devanar Mahal, that is the daughters of God, and that they are women who lived within the precincts of the temple, the Thali, and that is why they are Thali Ilar. But we do find in inscriptions related to these women that they are mothers, that they are passing on their property, for instance, to their daughters and their children. We find references to them as concubines. In some rare instances, in one case, we even have a reference to one such woman as the wife of a king. So clearly what we have is that there are certain things that are recorded, but you also have certain practices that existed. So while these women were supposed to be outside of the marriage structure, you did find that they did have some kind of marital relations in some instances. We also, of course, have a large number of references to the category of women we may call prostitutes. In Tamil, they are referred to as Varaivin Mahali, women who take money for sexual favors, and also Veshi and other such terms that are used for them. You have even amongst these women certain categories. So you have the Ganikas, who are of a higher standing, and you find references to such women who are very accomplished in the arts and so on. But the fact is that the prostitutes are looked down upon. They are a category of women who are seen as not belonging to the good families and so on. So there are these, again, tangential references of this kind through which we can construct such a history for them. But very interestingly, when we look at temples across this region, we find sculptures all over them of dancing women. Who were these dancing women? They could have been professional dancers who made their living by singing and dancing and entertaining, or they could have been these temple women who are within the temples on whom the sculptors modeled these beautiful dancing sculptures. The next slide, please. Now, as far as the last thing that I thought I would flag with you is concerned, where we have women and religion and women in religion, you have a large number of inscriptions which tell us about women in the Brahmanical tradition and in the Jain tradition. Within Buddhism, they are less visible during this time period. The Jain women are referred to as Kuratis and Manakyars. This is the Kargumalai cave that I have an image of over here, where you have so many of these niches showing all the Tirthankaras and so on, and various figures that are of importance in the Jain tradition. And it is believed that in the Tamil Jaina tradition, women held a very high position. We have a number of references to them having titles which indicate that they are gurus or acharyas, that they hold a high position. It has been conjectured by some scholars that in Kanyakumari, where we have a number of these caves where particularly women are mentioned, that it is possibly this was a place where you had some kind of training for the women initiates at this particular place. In fact, they use terms like university for it to refer to it, but essentially a place where they could learn the tenets of the tradition that existed. So clearly women found a space, found a place within the religious traditions. In Jainism, it is very conspicuous. It is even more conspicuous in the Brahmanical traditions, particularly the kind of temple-centric bhakti religion that develops at this point of time, where we find that there are large number of stories in which women are visible as bhaktas. However, it is primarily the male bhakta who is eulogized. It is in association with the male bhakta that these women also become visible to us. There are very few women who directly, therefore, are talked about even within the bhakti tradition. Bhakti, of course, is a tradition where the devotion to the deity is given primacy, and so you do not need mediation, you do not need to perform rituals and sacrifices and so on. Any ordinary person could engage in this kind of worship. And in the Shaiva and Vaishnava traditions, as they develop at this point of time, through the medium of bhakti, you have saints who go about from one place to another singing about gods. In some places there are already built temples, but in some places there's just wilderness, and they're going to those places and they say that even in the middle of the forest, on top of these rocks, surrounded by these animals, I see you and I worship you over here. And these then become what are called the Padal Petra Sthalams, sthalas where songs are composed by these saints who then get eulogized. The saints themselves find a place within the temples, the places that they are sung of where there are no prior temples. There you have new temples that are being built. Now, with the Shaiva saint tradition and the Vaishnava saint tradition, that is, they are referred to as the Nayanars and the Alvars, we find that there are certain number of saints who are apotheosized. Amongst the Shaivas, it is 63 who are given a canonical position, and amongst the Vaishnavas, it is 12. But amongst those 63, it is only 3 who are women for the Shaivas. And for the Vaishnavas, amongst the 12, it is only 1 who is a woman. In the Shaiva tradition, there are 2 women who are given importance primarily because of their role in converting their male members of the family. It is only 1 woman who is Kare Kalamayar, a saint who is believed to have lived in the 6th century AD, whom we find composing poems, who talks about the importance of devotion, and who's very much part of the new cultural ethos, the Brahmanical ethos that is now appearing in the Tamil region, that is becoming very prominent in the Tamil region. So the Puranic ideas, epic Puranic motifs, even Vedic references that are there in these compositions that are there. And Kare Kalamayar was amongst the earliest who was propounding those kinds of ideas in the Tamil context. The Vaishnava saint that we have is the woman, young girl called Andal. She is believed to have lived in the 8th century. And what we have in her biography is again, or in her poetry, sorry, is again but especially to Vishnu, who is lying on his serpent bed. Vishnu, who is Ranganatha, the lord of Srirangam, a very, very important Vaishnava site at the time when she was composing her poetry. The next slide, please. And I will end with a few of these examples. These are just to give you some examples of the kind of poetry, the kind of writing by these women. Because as I've already said, most of our sources don't really give you the woman's voice. Here we have these two women, Karaikal Ammaiyar and Andaal, who are writing themselves, who are composing these poetry. And these poems, while they may be very typical of the Bhakti tradition, they're referring to similar kinds of things and so on. There are also some very important distinctions in the writings of Karaikal Ammaiyar and Andaal. And that's what I've highlighted by choosing just these two or three examples where she talks of herself as a female pei, a demoness. And she says that she has shrunken breasts and bulging veins and protruding eyes, white teeth and sunken stomach. She's red-haired. She has jutting teeth. Just look at the horrific descriptions of herself that she is giving. And that she is shouting and wailing and wandering about in the forest. So like a demonic presence or spirit, she's walking around in the forest, but she's walking fearlessly. Why? Because this is the forest of Shiva and she is a devotee of Shiva. And she is amongst those Shaiva saints who talks extensively about Shiva's dance, and her view or vision of Shiva's dance is this very fiery dance where his head is splayed out, where he's just dancing with total abandonment. And you see that in her descriptions of Shiva with his hair splayed out, where his movement itself is like a whirl. She talks about it in her descriptions and so on. The next slide, please. So here you have a beautiful description of the body of Shiva. In the previous slide, the image that I used belongs to the second half of this early medieval period. Once the saints become canonized, once they become institutionalized, and there are in temples special services that are performed for the saints, you have images of the saints that are made and kept within the temples. You have that kind. So can I show you the previous slide again, please? I'm so sorry. I should have pointed this out earlier. So you have these kinds of figuring of the body of Karaikal Ammaiyar, where she's shown with her hanging breasts and so on. In a later slide, you will find a more visibly representative image of Karaikal Ammaiyar as she describes herself. The next slide. This is an image from Gangaikonda Cholapuram. I mentioned the southern Devakoshta where Nataraja gets a place because of Chembiyan Mahadevi's architectural innovations. And so in Gangaikonda Cholapuram, the great temple built by Rajendra Chola, here you have the dancing Shiva. At his feet, you have a dancing Kali, on which I have written extensively in my work on the making of the goddess. But here, right at the bottom, we have this female figure who is Karaikal Ammaiyar. So very clearly, she was given a place as one at the feet of Shiva, watching him dance. And so you have all these beautiful descriptions of her, primarily talking about his dance in the forest, but also talking of some kind of a celestial dance of Shiva. The next slide, please. So one of the things that you find in her description, and that possibly explains why she sees herself in that manner with jutting teeth and, you know, totally emaciated and so on, she sees herself as one of Shiva's gunners. Now, the gunners, if for anyone who has some understanding of the Puranic mythology, the gunners were always seen as those who did not follow certain social norms. Generally, they find representation as short, pot-bellied, drunk, and so on in literary texts. But in Karaikal's, Ammaiyar's imagination, it is one who doesn't care for her experience as a woman gana, because amongst Shiva's ganas, very rarely do you have explicit references to the women. But for her, as a woman, who is a part of the entourage of Shiva as a gana, she sees herself as without any bodily attraction, as someone who is totally not fitting with social norms. So that's something that she actually seems to exult in her descriptions of herself. The next slide, please. Now, in a 12th century text called the Periya Puranam, which is a hagiography of the Tamil Shaiva saints, we find the full description of the story of Karaikal Ammayar. We are told, and here, you know, very many things come together. So those three different themes that I was talking of resources and agency, of kinship and marriage, as well as of religion, they all come together in this particular story, where this woman is from a rich merchant's family, married to another such young man, and that he once brings back home two very exotic fruits and tells her to keep them away, that he will go to work and come back and he will take them. But when she is busy with her household work, there is a Shaiva ascetic who comes begging at her door, and he asks her to give him something to eat, and because the food is not yet ready, she gives him one of the fruits that was there. Now the husband comes back and he asks her for the fruit. She has cooked food, she feeds him and then gives him the fruit, and then he likes that fruit so much, he doesn't say share it with me, he says bring me the other fruit, I want to eat that as well. And when she is tongue-tied, unable to think of what to do, she prays to Lord Shiva, we are told in the hagiography, and miraculously this fruit appears in her hands, and then she takes it to her husband. Her husband eats that fruit all by himself, but he says, this is not the same as the fruit I gave you earlier. Where did you get this from? Tell me the truth. And then she tells him, and he says, oh no, you're not an ordinary woman. How can I live with you? You are a goddess. He falls at her feet and he just abandons her and he goes away. And then she keeps waiting for him like a pativrata until she, her relatives find out that he has married, he has shifted to another place, he has married, he has a child whom he has named after his first wife. So at which point she says, I relinquish everything. No more marriage, no more family. I have been redeemed. I have been relieved by the man. So then she takes on the life of a Shaiva devotee. She goes from place to place. And it is her wish to see Shiva on Mount Kailash, his abode. And so she sets off on this long and arduous journey. And in the course of her renouncing her social life, she gives up her body. She cuts off her hair. She starves herself and begins to look so ghoulish and so demonic that everybody is scared of her. And then she goes towards Mount Kailash. And once she reaches Mount Kailash, she does not want her feet should touch the holy mountain. So what does she do? She goes on her hands on the mountain and climbs all the way up to get her vision of Shiva. And we are told, the story goes on, that Shiva, in fact, there is a reference even in the 10th century to this particular part, that there is a list of the 63 saints during the time of Rajaraja Chola that is compiled. In that, there is this description that this Karaikal Ammayar is the one whom Lord Shiva called Amma. So now the Periya Puranam tells us, what did Shiva do when he saw Karaikal Ammayar coming up? He came before her and he said, Amma, come here. So, you know, the way in which in a 12th century text, we get a full explication of the story. There are obviously many legendary elements that are brought into this story. But clearly what we are seeing is some kind of possible legitimation that is being given to a woman in public life, that it can only be a woman who does not have a husband who can actually come out into the public arena, into the public domain. Possibly this is one of the reasons why there's so much of harping in the hagiography over this. So even between the early first part of the early medieval and later part of the early medieval, there is a change, there are changes and transformations. And possibly the idea of the marriage and family as being very important to mark an identity of a woman, as Engels has pointed out, after all, It is with the coming of property that the idea of marriage becomes more and more important. So once a very complex kind of understanding of property has come up, and land ownership and other kinds of control over the economic resources has come up in the early medieval period, it's at that point of time possibly that we have this kind of an elaboration where the woman, we are told, does not have any control even over a fruit that has been given to her by the husband, that whatever is there, even in terms of food, the husband is the one who first will partake of it. And of course, we know that in some obscurantist circles, that these are things that that may be wished for, very wishful thinking indeed, fortunately. But what we have is clearly in this kind of telling, there seems to be a tightening of societal norms to my mind, where we are given an explanation. How is it otherwise that a woman like Karaikal Ammayar could be in the forest, could be out there seeing Shiva's dance, talking about Shiva, singing about him and so on, and talking about her own body in this manner? Some truth, some legend, and certainly some normative ideas that come into this. The last discussion, I think maybe I'll stop over here. I wanted to talk about Andal, but if I've run out of time, I know I have. I'm willing to stop over here.
It all depends on you, I mean.
Okay, so then let me just, I'll quickly sum up. I won't take more than about 7 minutes or so. So may I have that slide again? Can we go to the next one, which is of Andal? I'm sorry, Andal. What you will find in the poetry of Andal is, so this is actually a 12th century temple sculpture from Dara. Shows Karaikal Ammayar with her hands down. It's like a headstand, no, like a Shirshasana. And she seems to, here. This is the figure. Can you see that? The arrow is pointing to her head. Can you see her? Yeah, and she's going up in this manner. And as I said already, the figure below is the typical image that we have of Karaikal Ammayar with a very emaciated body. The next slide, please. Now, the poetry of Andal is very, very different from that of Karaikal Ammayar. While Karaikal Ammayar is telling you about her horrific body, in the poetry of Andal, what you find is a celebration of the body. The beauty of the body itself is being celebrated, and she describes the body of her object of devotion, Vishnu, Ranganatha, in such beautiful terms. She talks about the beauty of his mouth, of his face, of the garlands that he wears, the things that he holds in his hand, and so on. And she is constantly talking about her desire to unite with this beautiful god who is the object of her devotion. The next slide, please. You have in this particular verse and many others like this, a very erotic representation of the self, where she talks about her own breasts, about how she is yearning for the eyes, for the touch, where she is shunning mortals, but she wants that the object of her devotion, whom she refers to by various names, but here it is Govinda, that he would actually assuage her desires, that he would fulfill her desires. The last slide. Here again, you find that the same kind of description. So it's primarily in terms of a sexual union, in terms of her the breasts as being an erotic point that is used in a lot of poetry. By this point of time, you have the Kavya tradition that is very well established, where such descriptions are very common. And you have in Andal's work that kind of a reference to the body where certain parts of the body are highlighted and talked of in erotic terms. And as I've already mentioned, sexual union is what she's talking about. So what a contrast when you think about Karaikal Ammaiyar and you think about someone like Aandaal, right? So one we are looking at as someone who is, trying to actually dissociate herself from any physical beauty, whereas the other is trying to highlight and emphasize her physical beauty. So that's something that's quite striking in the words of Aandaal. The next slide. Yeah. Now, in the later hagiographies that we have of the Vaishnava saints, in the case of the Vaishnava saints, we have not one but several hagiographies that are written through the medieval period. And in all of these, we are told that this Brahmin in Srivilliputtur found this young girl. And just like, you know, so you can see the way in which the story resonates with the finding of Sita by Janaka. In the Ramayana. So you have him finding this little girl child. He brings her up as his own. He makes the garlands for the deity in the temple. And of course, given the Brahmanical norms of purity, that only his hands could touch it. And he would keep that aside before getting ready to go to the temple. In that brief space of time, this little girl would go and take that garland and put it on herself, because she had already fallen in love with the god in the temple. And so one day her father finds out about this and is very angry with her for it. But you have that the god himself asks that she be brought to him. And we are told that she has this beautiful composition where she dreams of her marriage to the deity and her union with the deity. And the story ends with her dissolving into the image of the deity itself. What does it mean in a social sense? I think we need to think very critically, not emotionally, not as theologians only, but as those who know about what happens to women who transgress certain social norms. Even today in Tamil Nadu, when women marry outside of their caste, we are talking of marriage outside of their caste, we know the kind of end that they meet. Is this story hinting at something of this sort? We don't know. It's just one way in which we can, or one possibility that we can think of amongst many others, but that the story ends this young, beautiful woman's life just at the peak of her maturity. She's just 16 years old when we are told she merges into the figure of the deity. I think these kinds of legends raise very important questions for us, and we need to bring up these questions even if they are uncomfortable for us. I will stop here. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, and I would be very happy if there are any clarifications or any questions to answer them.
Absolutely fantastic lecture. I mean, I think I learned a lot from what you spoke today. We have taken more than 1.5 hours, so we would not be taking too many questions. We will confine ourselves to some. So let us have the first question, which is by Zainab Naqvi. Thanks a lot for the interesting lecture. In terms of religion and gender, would you mention a bit on the hagiographical traditions of bhakti and how bhakti became a ground for women saints to escape the Brahminical ritual world and also transcend the socially determined gender roles through religious renouncement in the region concerned?
Thank you so much, Zainab Naqviji. I mean, this is a wonderful question. I think you have hit at the crux of the issue. that are we looking at religion, the fact that women feature prominently in religious traditions. And so this is not merely for this region. This is also in the context of Buddhism, whether in North India, in Western India, or in South India. This is also the a question to be raised with regard to Jainism across the subcontinent. And scholars have raised this issue, as I mentioned already, in the context of the Therigatha and Theriyapadan. Scholars have been raising these kinds of issues, that are we to understand from the women themselves, when we are able to hear their voices, that religion was actually providing them with a space to escape from domestic drudgery, escape from social shackles. In the Therigatha, we have numerous such instances where women are saying, I don't want the pestle and the mortar anymore. I am sick of it. I don't want to do this chula, bartan, and so on. I mean, I'm paraphrasing, of course, but essentially that's what they are saying. And you also have women saying that I don't want to live with that man. The crooked husband who's hunchbacked, who's lazy, who's just lying there and expects me to do all the work. I just don't want it. The gathas are very explicit in this regard. We unfortunately don't find such explicit discussion in other kinds of sources. Now, and so as far as the bhakti, the tradition is concerned, as I've already mentioned, the bhakti saints' compositions belong to the earlier period between the 6th and the 10th centuries. Or the 9th century. And the hagiographical tradition actually belongs to a much later period of about the 12th century, from the 12th century onwards. Now, what we find is in the bhakti saints' compositions themselves, there is a reference to their own desires, their own feelings, and they are pronouncing their own kind of bhakti. There is no typical standard format. In fact, the Tamil tradition is quite wonderful. If you look at the compositions themselves, you have men talking in women's voices. You have saints who are comparing themselves to the mother of Krishna, and who see themselves as, you know, needing to admonish this child, this naughty child, and so on. So that kind of transformation of the self from the male to the female is also possible. That's a different aspect of gender that we find in these poems. We also find those poems where the male sees himself as a lover of the god. So it's actually quite a fabulous tradition if we were to look at it in detail in terms of the gender norms that are being broken, the stereotypes that we have of a male body and female body, meaning that you also have certain social functions and ways of being. That is something that you will find that is not being conformed to in the bhakti saints' compositions. So clearly the compositions are telling you one kind of story. The hagiographies are giving you what they claim is the real story of the lives of the saints. Now, in that telling of the lives of the saints, it is my understanding that given that this is a period when you have an extremely complex, social hierarchy that has emerged, although you have caste that can be identified, class distinctions identified, even in the first half of the early medieval period, it is really the second half which sees the concretization in fundamental ways of these hierarchies, where even amongst those who are seen as in the southern tradition, as I've already mentioned, you have the Brahmanas who can clearly be identified, you have the ruling class who can be identified, but the other castes are broadly divided into right and left. Some would claim that the right-hand castes are superior. Others would say that no. What we are looking at is really an accommodation of new social groups by using this difference of the right and the left-hand caste. So the new agriculturists would come in as part of the left-hand caste and so on. So there is a very broad-based, a social organization that we can see a large number of communities which are becoming more and more wealthy, as we see from inscriptions. It is at this point of time that these hagiographies are also being written. And possibly they are reflecting certain new kinds of norms that are being upheld in this society. And that is why there's so much of emphasis on the woman, how she's cooking, how she's a total pativrata till that moment the husband throws her out of the house. Now, there are other stories, not about women saints, but about the wives of male saints or even the daughters of male saints, where just, you know, for the flimsiest of reasons, the male saints would commit horrendous kind of violence on the women. So, for instance, there is this particular instance where a woman refuses to wash the feet of the servant, because the husband realizes the servant is a Shaiva devotee, Shiva devotee. He says, I also want to, you know, I have to worship him because he's a devotee of Shiva. And Shiva is my lord and master. So anyone who is his devotee is also someone I respect. So he wants that his feet be washed because that's a mark of respect. Now, the wife says that she will not do it. So class difference that is there. But what does the husband do? He says, I'm going to chop your hands off. And then anyway, finally, the story is where everything is resolved and Shiva comes and blesses the devotee and says, you are such a great devotee that you are willing to even cut off your wife's hand. So other such stories that are there. For instance, there's one in which an aghori comes to the house of this man whose daughter is getting married. Now, this man is, again, a great devotee. This daughter is very beautiful. She's born after a lot of rituals and all are performed. Now, this aghori says he wants to make a garland with the hair, real hair of someone. And he says, I want the hair only of your daughter. Okay? Now, generally, you know, in the subcontinent and different traditions. So even in the Buddhist tradition, one very important element when you move from home to homelessness, that is when you become a renunciate, is to pluck out the hair, right? So it means basically a social renunciation. In the Brahmanical tradition, you have practices such as the cutting of the hair of the widow, right? Here is this young girl who is so beautiful, who is praised for her hair. They know the descriptions of how it's like a jungle and so aromatic and beautiful, black dresses and so on. This day of her life, which is an important day, her marriage day, she is asked by her father to shave off her hair and to give it to that aghori, right? So these are clearly indicating to us that while, yes, the women are also praised, the daughter is also praised. Later, the ending is such, is the father praised, but the daughter is also praised. By the way, it is not just the daughter's husband who marries her even without her hair. He is also praised at the end of the story, right? So clearly, it's showing you a patriarchal structure where women are seen as subordinate. They have no agency as far as their own bodies are concerned or their actions are concerned. And you have several such instances that that really make us question whether we can very emphatically say that women found their spaces in religion. Maybe religion provided them some kind of space, but whether it was an equal space or not is something that is clearly under doubt. I would think that we need to be cautious in seeing religion as providing some kind of absolute space to women.
Thank you, Professor Mahalakshmi, for a very detailed answer. And thank you, Zainab, for asking this very important question, because I mean, there was something which I was also going to ask, but that has been covered by the answer which Maha gave to you. Malini Adiga, is Malini Adiga asking something?
Speaking more of a comment.
It's just a comment. Well, I mean, Maha, I think we have exceeded the time. So possibly we won't be taking many other questions. If there is any very important one, then we can put it up. In the meanwhile, I'll just be asking one or two very small queries of mine. I hope I have the privilege.
Absolutely.
However bad queries there are, I'm no expert of this field, neither of South India nor of gender studies. But what I find interesting is that although when you started with the lecture, it appeared that there is much difference between North and the South. In fact, I was half through your lecture, I was thinking that because of the type of information which you have, that differentiates the North from the South as far as gender is concerned. But ultimately, when you came to the second part of your lecture, it appeared that there was hardly any difference of perception of the gender roles. However, I mean, I find two things missing from this discussion. Do you find any craftswomen, any professional women who are mentioned? I suppose they may not have been mentioned because these are all mostly inscriptions related with the temples, but any weavers, spinners, any such kind of professional women who are being mentioned? Yeah. Secondly, if so, then are their wages mentioned? I mean, I remember you talking about that some of these women have been mentioned, but the wages have actually not been given. In the North also, I mean, while I was working on the organization of building construction, it was very hard to get any information regarding the female labor. I mean, Abul Fazal has given a full list. The Arsatta Imartis are full of information of the wages. But look, whether in the 18th century Arsattas or 17th century Abul Fazal, no mention of the women. Although in Arsattas, what we find is that there are certain times where half the wage is mentioned. Okay. In point. One and a half laborers were paid. So, I mean, there can be a discussion whether half meant a child labor, a woman labor. We know that through the Mughal paintings that women were working on these sites. That's what I find. Yeah. So possibly it was meant for them, but any information regarding your this thing. Secondly, or thirdly, I may say, and the last thing which I would like to ask you is that any information you talk about the gave details about two women, Karaikal and Antar, both were poetesses. You told them their legends, their stories. You also showed us the slide of their verses which they had composed. Now, my question is, any information regarding the education of the women? How were they educated? Were their education at par, or any reference at all regarding them? These are some of the queries which I have.
Thank you so very much. Unfortunately, we do not have any sources of the kind that you have for the Mughal period, for this time period in my region. But what, as I've already said, we find marginal references, we find passing references from that we try to reconstruct. As such, we don't have for this time period any references to women who are craftspersons. We have a lot of references to the scribes. We have references to the sthapatis, those who are building the sculptors. You have a lot of these kinds of references, but you don't have the women. Even in North India, you have maybe one or two references. Professor Aryan Mishra has referred to this in his work on artists and artisans. The point is that we know from ethnographic studies that women definitely participated. That's merely what I was trying to highlight. We know that they participated. And as I've already said, terms like cultivator or like potter or washerman are not telling us, either they are used in a generic way or that they are specifically referring to men's work, which is given value. That is a possibility, because the fact is that even where we are talking of a washerman, it is invariably the women who are involved in the washing work along with the men. So I don't think that, we can foreclose that possibility just because we don't have a written reference to it. That is a point that I wanted to make quite clearly. And The thing about the education, again, what we have is reference to Brahmanical institutions of education. We have the shalas that are there for military kind of education. We have, except for this reference that scholars have drawn our attention to, where in the Pandya country, in Kanyakumari region, there is a school, or they call it, as I've said, a university for Jaina women, we don't really have such references. So again, it is only when they take to the religious path and come into the Jaina path that their education itself is brought to the limelight. Otherwise, it's not there. Exactly. But obviously, there were many women who were educated, because even earlier, or at the beginning of the early medieval period, you have Tamil epics like the Shilapadiharam and Manimekhalai, in which there are references to these women and all the arts that they are learning. They have to learn Kavya because they need to express themselves. It's not enough to just have the physical training, of the technique. They also need to understand the legends, the myths. So you have references in epics of that kind to such such accomplishments by women, the training by women. In Shilapadiharam, the description that we have of Madhavi is that she's just 12 years old when she has already accomplished so much, she's learned and read so much. We're not told that she's read it, but she's taught so much. And she has learned so much. So that is something that we can hone out from our sources. But I'm afraid that my answer to you is that largely we don't have any direct evidence of women being taught in a formal manner at all. But again, Ramya Srinivasan in her work on, it's not Ramya Srinivasan, I'm sorry, it's this other scholar who's talking about women in ancient India, where she says that, just even in the legendary fight between Shankara and Mandana Maharishi, where Shankara is on his tour across the Indian subcontinent, according to the legend. And then he comes to this ashrama of Mandana Maharishi, who is supposed to be this great scholar. And he starts having a debate with him. But ultimately, it's Mandana Maharishi's wife who defeats Shankara in the debate, right? So clearly, there may have been informal structures, or there were formal structures, but and women were included. But since they were not meant to be the main recipients of that knowledge, they are not even mentioned as receiving that knowledge, right?
So. Thank you very much for this information. In fact, that also tallies very much with the information which we have for North, even for the Mughals. We know that Gulbadan Banu Begum was much more learned than her own husband, who could not even sign his own name. So there are certain examples, but we are fortunate enough that During the 17th century, we do find certain Mughal miniatures where the madrasa scene is reflected, shown, where both males and females are studying. Thank you very much, Professor Mahalakshmi, for a really enchanting lecture. I wish we could have asked more questions, but we are, you know, closing in into 2 hours of this beautiful discussion, a beautiful lecture. I must thank you once again, and I must elicit one promise from you live on this show, that please be with us once again with your enchanting way of speaking. Thank you, Uma.
Thank you so very much. Thank you. It's been my pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Goodbye. Good night.
Bye-bye.